Hachette Audio presents The Way Forward, Renewing the American Idea. Written by Paul Ryan. Read by Jonathan Davis. With an introduction read by the author.
This book is dedicated to Jana, Liza, Charlie, and Sam, and in memory of Paul M. Ryan and Prudence M. Little. Introduction. Hello, this is Paul Ryan. I should probably explain at the outset that I never expected to write a book, and that's just one in a long list of experiences I never imagined I'd have. I didn't expect to work in Washington, D.C. for very long, or to find that work so compelling that I would come to view public policy as a worthy vocation. I never thought I'd run for Congress. And when I embarked on my first campaign, at just 28 years old, I didn't think I would likely win. And I certainly never thought that I'd become the GOP vice presidential nominee. And yet, it's these unexpected moments that have provided the best opportunities to work on the issues I care about. Economic growth, saving Medicare and Social Security, fixing our broken healthcare system, and passing on to the next generation a nation that is secure and debt-free. These are the kinds of challenges that ideally would bring out the best in both parties. After all, such concerns aren't the exclusive domain of liberals or conservatives, and there's common ground to be found. Yet nearly 2 years have passed since our last presidential election, and we still find ourselves moving in the wrong direction. We've doubled down on a lot of the programs and policies that got us off course in the first place. And the true price of this state of affairs is the erosion of the American idea, a way of life made possible by our commitment to the principles of freedom and equality, and rooted in our respect for every person's natural rights. When we speak about America as being exceptional, this is in part what we mean. And when people talk about our country being on the wrong track, this is what's at stake. Of course, these days it's not talk about our problems that is in short supply. What's missing is fresh thinking, good solutions, and real leadership. In this moment, we are framing up America for the 21st century. The questions before us are these. How do we preserve the American idea for the next generation? How do we ensure this experiment in liberty endures? And finding the answers to those questions starts with an honest debate about the different paths before us and the choices we have to make. One path, the course that liberal progressivism is offering, is a government-centered approach. Along this path, the federal government continues to expand, attempting to meet our every need with outdated policies that put the state at the center of our lives. It leads to a future in which America's best century is the last century. It's a future in which the American idea is in serious jeopardy. The second path puts society, not government, at the center of American life. Through a restoration of our founding principles, it expands freedom and fosters risk-taking, ingenuity, and creativity. Instead of growing government, it grows the economy, offering greater opportunity and prosperity for all. Along this path, government provides the necessary support rather than taking on the commanding role. Mapping this path has been the focus of much of my work in Congress. Of course, my hope wasn't that I'd be writing about these ideas. I thought I'd be helping implement them as part of a Romney administration. But it didn't take long for me to realize that while we may have lost an election, the cause continues. And those of us who are privileged to serve in public office have a duty to offer our fellow citizens a real and meaningful choice about the way forward. This audiobook is my contribution to that conversation. When I sat down to write, I had two questions in front of me. The first was, how did we get here? That question guides part one of this audiobook. It traces my own journey, which runs through Janesville, Wisconsin, where I grew up and first learned about the American idea. And it discusses how, as a country, we slid further away from that idea, first because Republicans failed to stay true to our principles, and then because of the liberal progressive agenda that President Obama has pursued. While part one of this audiobook includes my recollections of people and events over the years, this is not an exhaustive memoir. Where those things exist, it is simply to explain my thinking and what was happening from my viewpoint at the time. It is also not intended to be a comprehensive history. The events and conversations discussed are described as I remember them, and if I have made misstatements, it is not a product of ill intent, but simply the limits of memory contending with the passage of time. In writing this book, the other question I considered was, where do we go from here? Part two of this audiobook answers that question, first, by looking at what liberal progressivism is offering and the vision that conservatism can deliver. I believe the conservative vision can appeal to the majority of our fellow citizens. It offers a way of life that consists of a dynamic economy, a thriving civil society, and a government that protects our rights while offering a real safety net for those in need without overpowering the private economy and the private lives of citizens. And while the best vehicle for conservative thought and policies is the Republican Party, the GOP faces serious challenges that, in recent years, have led to critical losses at the polls. Part 2 tackles this issue as well, describing the Republican Party's current vulnerabilities. Among them, the caricature of the party that the left has promoted, and the ways in which the GOP itself has played into that caricature instead of disproving it. In this audiobook, I attempt to offer some ideas about how the party can overcome this challenge and others, and reach out to Americans from every walk of life. While it's true that our country's current problems are urgent and real, I don't view them as insurmountable. When I visit our big cities and our small-town communities, I see our untapped potential and the signs of a great American comeback in the making. And I know if we make the right decision, if we choose the path that restores our founding principles and puts society, not government, at the center of American life, then we can renew the American idea. The time is right. The need is urgent. And I know we can find the way forward.
Part 1. How we got here. Chapter 1. A Tale of Two Cities. When the day finally came, I changed out of my suit, threw on a camouflage hat and shirt, and slipped out the back. In hindsight, I probably could have done without the camo. It was broad daylight, and I was surrounded by neighbors I'd known my whole life, and media trackers who had spent 3 weeks reporting my every move. Any one of them could easily have spotted me. It was July 2012, and the press was eager for any indication that Mitt Romney had picked his running mate. Reporters from ABC and NBC camped out in my front yard, trying to figure out if I was missing so they could report that an announcement was coming. Frankly, my wife Jana and I thought that anyone looking for breaking news on our lawn in Janesville that summer was going to be disappointed. In the days leading up to the Wisconsin primary on April 3rd, Mitt Romney and I had crisscrossed the state campaigning. We grabbed food at Culver's in Johnson Creek. I introduced him to my cousin at Schneider's restaurant in Fond du Lac. We visited with phone bank volunteers in Fitchburg. Along the way, we got to know one another. We talked about faith, my Catholicism, his Mormonism. We shared stories about our kids. We had long discussions about economics and what his initial legislative push would look like if he were elected president. We discussed what his first budget proposal would include and which tax and entitlement reforms he would advance to help get the economy growing and our debt under control. By the time we'd wrapped up our trip, I thought Mitt Romney would make an outstanding president, but I did not think I'd be his choice for a running mate. For starters, word had it that the short list was pretty long and included a lot of first-rate names. Chris Christie, Tim Pawlenty, Kelly Ayotte, Marco Rubio, Condoleezza Rice, Rob Portman, and John Thune. Then there was the matter of my work as chairman of the House Budget Committee. I was and am proud of the budget proposals we produced, but they contained a kind of specifics that can be easily mischaracterized in the rough-and-tumble, soundbite atmosphere of a presidential campaign. There were also the changes I'd proposed to shore up Social Security and Medicare. If Mitt added me to the ticket, he would own them and have to defend them too. I wasn't sure that was something he or his strategists would want to do.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.